In Cormac McCarthy's Pulitzer Prize-winning 2006 novel, The Road, there is a moment when a young boy, nameless despite being one of two main characters, sees something regrettably memorable. A father and a son are making their way through the remains of a town, passing by crumbling structures and broken glass until they come across the inevitable, the remains of a human, long dead and decomposing. It's worth mentioning right now only because it's true, McCarthy is a treasure. The Road is the story of a man who survived the end of the world and is now on a quest across post-apocalyptic America, tasked with keeping a young child alive along the journey, and I know that sounds a little played out. The post-apocalyptic setting has become so cliché that we now need to specify what type of post-apocalypse we're talking about. However, keep in mind this novel was published in 2006. The title of this essay is not Why Cormac McCarthy is Responsible for at least 50% of Popular Fiction, but I hope that essay exists. The Road is written in such elegant prose that I found myself regularly looking up McCarthy's $100 words because I needed to know what he was seeing, and finding that the definitions of these words immaculately described whatever bleak scene was unfolding in the narrative. A single sentence of The Road can be poetic and haunting and direct and multi-layered and devastatingly uplifting all at the same time, and of course the same could be said about the novel as a whole. In other words, a sentence or a novel written by Cormac McCarthy will be a tough read for more than one reason, and it will always be worth the effort. As The Road progresses, this father and child and us reading will witness increasingly awful behavior and set pieces, described in brutally direct language in stark contrast to some of the poetic prose found during the more peaceful parts of the story. But this first decaying corpse that we see in the story is mentioned briefly, casually, because even the young child understands that in this world, decaying corpse is unsightly but not uncommon. He pulled the boy closer. "Just remember that the things you put into your head are there forever," he said. "You might want to think about that." "You forget some things, don't you?" "Yes. You forget what you want to remember, and you remember what you want to forget." If you've done a modicum of research on the topic, you know that people's memories are flawed. Eyewitness accounts of crimes have become all but inadmissible unless corroborated en masse. History is fluid and fickle, subject to the whims of the audience and the accessibility of its author. Valuable experiences that you yourself have had are buried somewhere underneath the routine of where you left your car keys, sometimes excavated by a distinct smell or an old song, sometimes never to be unearthed again. There is a recurring line of dialogue in Paul Thomas Anderson's 1999 epic Magnolia, delivered at least by Philip Baker Hall and William H. Macy throughout the film. "We may be through with the past, but the past ain't through with us." We can't rely on our memory for very much when it comes down to it, and yet our memories are our identity. We are what we've done. We are this big snowball of people we've met and places visited and lessons learned. We rely on our past to inform who we are in the present. And yet, I started my channel about 6 months ago, and though I certainly haven't recorded every minute of video games I played since then, it probably shouldn't come as a surprise that I've recorded a lot of it. Even when I'm playing a game that I have no intention of making a video about, you never know when the footage might be useful. In 6 months, I've captured 1,796 gigabytes worth of footage, or just short of 2 terabytes. The debate rages on about how much storage space the human brain ships with. The simplest way neuroscientists have found to explain the potential is by calculating the amount of neurons in our head and the amount of data in bits that each neuron is capable of storing. In its most raw form, this simplistic calculation would suggest a capacity of somewhere between 2 and 10 terabytes of potential available space. As the study gets more complex, so do the results. Neurons are not only storing information, but amplifying the effectiveness of surrounding neurons, leading to increased storage space as more space is used. The result is an exponentially larger estimate of 2.5 petabytes of total storage potential. The hypothetical numbers are fascinating, but even if confirmed, would ultimately still prove useless because nobody knows how much size our memories take up. Knowing the potential maximum capacity would not inform anyone about how much space they have remaining. What scares me more than it should on a regular basis is the knowledge that, regardless of the number, I can wrap my head around the limit. I can fit 2 terabytes on one of my external hard drives, which is the most rudimentary estimate to a human brain storage capacity, and I filled it in 6 months. 2.5 petabytes, for what it's worth, is 2,500 terabytes, which would be 1,250 of my external hard drives. Is that an insane number of hard drives? Absolutely. I'd never be able to keep track of what was stored in each one, plus at some point Best Buy would probably stop giving me credit. And yet. It's easy to imagine the 64, and then 128, and then 256 terabyte hard drive becoming the new standard. It's easy to imagine needing 10 external hard drives to equal the potential storage capacity of the human brain instead of 1,250, and we still wouldn't know how much space a memory takes. No matter what, the storage capacity of the human brain is a finite number. And assuming the number is made smaller by autonomous pieces of information we prioritize over all the others, like how to breathe or the face of someone we love, it terrifies me how limited it all is, sure, but my fear is much deeper than that. I am not only scared that I don't have a gauge that will notify me when I've used up 90% of my space, I'm terrified because I have no file manager to prioritize dates or memory size. There's no prompt asking me to confirm if I truly want to delete a memory to be overwritten by a new one. In Season 1, Episode 8 of the Buffy the Vampire Slayer spinoff Angel, titled I Will Remember You, a pretty standard story plays out almost exactly like we'd expect, but with one heart-wrenching twist at the end. Buffy the Vampire Slayer is a girl chosen by the powers that be to slay vampires. This is not the twist. Angel is a vampire, cursed with a soul and a conscience, who feels guilt for all the people he's killed. He is in love with Buffy, and Buffy is in love with Angel, and still, this is not the twist either. By the time Angel received his own show, he and Buffy had realized that fate was going to conspire to keep them unhappy if they were together. In this episode, Buffy travels to Los Angeles and is lecturing Angel when a demon attacks them. They fight the demon, who wounds Angel before it escapes. The demon's blood had healing powers, and when it mixed with Angel's blood, it healed his dead body enough to bring him back to life. This eliminates the main barrier preventing him from a relationship with the human Buffy. The Slayers are repeatedly referred to as humans in this universe, despite clearly being superhuman. And the two of them are immediately caught up in these impulses. After sleeping together, which is a huge deal for the two of them, and after talking about their future, Angel goes out to prove he's not useless and slay the demon that had attacked them earlier. Unfortunately, without his vampire superpowers, he is outmatched by the demon and saved by Buffy. Realizing he is a liability to Buffy and that he can no longer help the people of Los Angeles, or possibly because he couldn't bear to feel inferior to a female, Angel goes to the powers that be and requests that they undo the healing powers from the demon's blood and turn him back into a vampire. The twist here is brutal. The powers that be agree to undo the damage by literally turning back time to before Angel was healed. Angel and Buffy's day of happiness together is to be taken away from them, the memories of the day, like it never happened. At the end of the episode, Buffy doesn't ask for much. She doesn't want to risk the lives of the people they should be helping, or their own safety, and besides, regardless if she agrees with Angel's choice or if she wishes he hadn't done it, it's too late. She just wants to remember. Our memories are our own. The sort of thing we always say can't be taken away from us. They shape us, they define us, and they inform us. As the seconds tick down and their one day together as a happy couple comes to an end, she knows it's futile, but she's a warrior, and so she says through her tears, she promises, whether to Angel or to herself, it's not clear, she promises, I'll never forget. I'll never forget. She is a different person with those memories than without them. And even though all of the coming days can't be like the ones she just spent, because of that, because they're a part of her, she mourns their loss. In Armature's 2021 narrative-based adventure game Where the Heart Leads, the ambitious story attempts to encapsulate the life of our player character, Whit Anderson. It's the kind of game that would struggle to stand out to gameplay junkies. We as players spend the entirety of the game walking around, talking to NPCs, and progressing a narrative. Every facet of gameplay has been constructed to deepen the story, and the majority of it advances the story as well. There's no vast open map to explore, though there is a town, and it is worth exploring, but only to advance the story. There's no intricate mechanics to master, though there are mechanics, and getting into their rhythm will affect how the story advances. In short, it's a game made for people like me. The context of Where the Heart Leads shifts between the game's chapters. There's a framing device that becomes contradictory or perhaps merely unnecessary by the end of the game. Because the game spans the length of the character's life, later stages see us playing in what could be a possible future timeline, one of the ways Wit's life could go. The first two chapters take place in the past, living out experiences Wit actually had in his life. One of the central conceits of this game, and countless others, is giving the player a choice and making that choice have consequences. In some fashion, games have been doing this since their inception, and though narrative-based games are relatively new, the concept has already been standardized. We are afforded the typical multiple choices for dialogue and decisions without being told directly how or when this might affect the rest of our experience. Games do this to increase immersion and to increase replay value, but few, if any, games have truly delivered a choice-making experience that satisfies everybody's expectations for that mechanic. Like its peers, Where the Heart Leads features over a dozen possible endings, presumably all shaped and earned by player choices along the way. Unlike a lot of its peers, because the beginning of the game is taking place in flashbacks, we are granted an extra layer into this vicarious decision-making, the ability to go back and do things differently. I believe the reason most people say they don't have any regrets is because they have never been given the opportunity to make good on any of them. Regrets as they are exist almost as a purely negative commodity, except for the occasional lesson learned. But if we could actually go back and change the things we regret, if we truly had the chance to do it differently, I think every one of us would take something back. In some circumstance, in some situation, we'd say yes instead of no, or no instead of yes. I played Wit's memories in the game from this perspective, in contrast to the other RPGs or walking sims with similar mechanics. Instead of doing what I thought Wit would do, I was able to throw myself into the narrative device and do what I thought Wit wished he would have done. The rest of the game unfolds more traditionally. We eventually reach a version of the present before the aforementioned version of the future, and at this point it feels more like we are playing as Wit, making real decisions that are actually affecting our outcome. The last chapter does its best to tie off the loose ends and pay off all the stories it told. The game took me a not inconsiderable 11 hours to complete, and part of the reason it's so effective is the video game medium allowing for truly epic runtimes. It's going to be subjective how successful the game is at pulling off a satisfying ending or being satisfying along the way. A common criticism of Where the Heart Leads appears to be its pacing, and this is a category of critiquing that I take very seriously. One critic complained that the story lacked a narrative structure, and that it was difficult to discern an inciting incident from a climax or a mundane event. Another several critics complained about the game being too long, which is contrary to the accusations leveled at most other video games. Having completed the game and having seen the credits roll, I'm confident that these critics at least partially missed the point of Where the Heart Leads. This is not to say that their observations are not valid, because they are. I personally prefer a narrative-based game to be about half the length of this game, and to be honest, there were a few story beats that probably could have been left out to streamline the experience. The problem is, look, the point of this game is to tell the story of a life, and streamlining it, complaining about its length, defeats the purpose. I've referred to the first two chapters as the first half of the game based on the number of chapters alone. In terms of gameplay and time spent, the first half of the game is more like the first three quarters. The game spends far more time exploring Wit's life through his memories, transporting him and us to the memories, but it's important to remember, we are exploring his memories, not the actual past. Everyone we know is an impossibly short walk away from each other. Outrageously long days allow for what should be weeks-long projects to be completed by sundown. The people we interact with are hazy afterimages of themselves, and they appear where they are needed without needing to walk around town the way we do. It's clear that we are experiencing these events as interactive memories, and because of this framing device, it's essentially irrelevant if it lacks structure. Wit is remembering these things because they're important to him, not because they're important to us as an audience. Some of his memories are huge watershed moments that altered the path of his life, just as many memories are seemingly innocuous conversations with his wife about where his deadbeat brother should live. We don't get to pick and choose which memories stay with us forever, and which get booted to the curb, irrevocably replaced by some shiny new memory that some neuron decided was more important. We don't get to decide if the monumental events in our life happen perfectly in the third act like a Hollywood screenplay, or if they happen right away and the rest of our life is spent yearning for some sense of climax again. It's probably apparent by now that Where the Heart Leads resonated with me. Present-day Wit seems to be about my age, and his troubles along the way are universal enough to make a good story. The story takes place in a Midwest town called Carthage, small enough that the residents appear to all know each other, large enough that the residents are divided over the proposed shopping malls and townhome complexes looming in the horizon. This is not the exact mirror image of the setting I was raised in, but it's closer than the mines of Kentucky Route Zero or the magical forest of Kena Bridge of Spirits. It's tempting for me to defend the game because the game spoke to me on these superficial levels, but the game got to me on a deeper level as well. When I think back on the times in my life when I could have been supportive instead of being angry, well, the only reason those conversations seem significant is because I regret them, and given the opportunity to go back to the past and change my actions, the end result might be completely unremarkable, just one of many conversations that I did not regret. There's a famous quote from Paul Bowles' 1949 novel, The Sheltering Sky, that is delivered in voiceover during the closing moments of the film adaptation of the same name. Because we don't know when we will die, we get to think of life as an inexhaustible well. And yet everything happens only a certain number of times, and a very small number, really. How many more times will you remember a certain afternoon of your childhood, an afternoon that is so deeply a part of your being that you can't even conceive of your life without it? Perhaps 4 or 5 times more? And perhaps not even that. How many more times will you watch the full moon rise? Perhaps 20. And yet, it all seems limitless. People who know me personally have likely seen me reference this quote before. And while it's a beautiful thought and entirely relevant throughout, it's the one question smack dab in the middle that haunts me. How many more times will you remember a certain afternoon of your childhood, an afternoon that is so deeply a part of your being that you can't even conceive of your life without it? Some people will tell you that your memories are always there, that they're buried down deep somewhere, but they're there, however inaccessible they might be. And sometimes that certain song or that certain smell will pull them out. Well, those triggers can activate the memories that are there, surely. But are all the memories there? Have I not recorded more than 1,250 hard drives yet? The truth is, we know that some stuff isn't there. A corrupted file, an encrypted file, an expertly hidden file takes up space, but it isn't there. If we can't recall it, we don't have it. In my life, I've experienced some wonderful things and some horrible things, and I can mostly say that as a statement of fact. But even the memories of those facts are imperfect. I was there, but my brain refuses to fill in the blanks when I ask it a question. And I know I have hilariously little control over it, but I try. I don't know how much space I have left, or how my soul decides which memories stay with me forever, ready to be plucked from the ether at a moment's notice, or which memories are ciphers, so utterly forgotten that there is nobody left to even suggest they occurred. But I try. When something worth remembering happens, I'll command myself to remember it, to encode it, to prioritize it. I'll tell myself that something happening right now is worth remembering. And we take pictures and videos, and we have records of these moments, hopefully the big ones and hopefully the small ones, and hopefully we have them forever. But pictures and videos, they're not memories. They just encourage memories. A picture by itself is an image, either ink or pixels, and it means nothing. A house or some people, if the memory isn't there, it literally has no meaning to us. The picture can't tell you how it felt to be on that stage, or in that wedding, or on that cliff. The picture can't tell you what you ate that day for lunch, or what song was in the background, or what her laugh sounded like, or why you were there in the first place. And we forget what we want to remember, and we remember. Nobody knows this story. These little insignificant moments, and all the big crucial moments in between, they make up my identity. And whether I remember them out of chronological order, or order of importance, or even inaccurately, I'm the only one who knows all of it. I'm the only one who has dedicated who knows how many terabytes to it. So all I can do is beg and hope. When something beautiful happens, when something is worth remembering, Please, let me remember. The things that I'll want to carry with me forever. The things that make me who I am. If I can't go back and relive them, and if I can't go back and change them, please. Please.